So this is the left lower limb. You are seeing the back of thigh and you are seeing the muscles of back of thigh. This one is semitendinosus. You can see its tendinous insertion. This one is semimembranosus. You can see its membranous origin. These two form the superomedial boundary of this diamond shaped popliteal fossa. And this is biceps femoris forming the superolateral boundary. This is the long head coming from ischial tuberosity, and then this one is the short head coming from the linea aspera femur. Here you can see, first we will see the three tendons of, now this is semitendinosus, then in front of it there is tendon of gracilis, and then in front of it there is tendon of sartorius. These three tendons are going towards their insertion on the upper part of medial surface of shaft of tibia, right? Then more, then let us first see the boundaries, the inferomedial and inferolateral boundaries. Inferomedial boundary is lateral head of gastrocnemius. Inferolateral boundary is lateral head of gastrocnemius, and taking origin slightly above it is this muscle, which is the plantaris muscle. Look at this muscle, it has a very small muscular belly. After that, can you see this very thin tendon? This is the tendon of plantaris. See, if I will pull on it, that tendon is full. This very thin tendon is the tendon of plantaris. And then more superficial structures lying in the roof of popliteal fossa. This is the small saphenous vein, and along it is lying the sural nerve, which is a cutaneous branch of the tibial nerve, right? So the contents of popliteal fossa, number one is the tibial and common Peyronie nerves, which are formed by division of sciatic nerve at the upper angle of the fossa. And then there is popliteal vein, and then there is popliteal artery. So at the top of the popliteal fossa, the relation from medial to lateral is artery, vein and nerve. In the middle of fossa, from superficial to deep, it is nerve, then vein, and deepest one is the artery. And then at the lower end of fossa, the relation from medial to lateral is, there is first nerve, then vein, and then artery. Okay, then you can see that tibial nerve is going to supply branches to all the muscles forming the boundaries of popliteal fossa. The branches to hamstrings have been given already. Then this is the branch you can see to medial head of gastrocnemius, then branch going to lateral head of gastrocnemius and plantaris. The branch to popliteus muscle, which popliteus forms the floor of the lower part of popliteal fossa. Here the fascia covering popliteus is visible. If we remove this fascia, then you will see the popliteus muscle. The nerve to popliteus goes down, winds around the lower border of popliteus, goes deep to it, that is supplies it from its interior surface, not posterior surface. And then what forms the floor of popliteal fossa? In the upper part of fossa, it is the popliteal surface of femur. In the middle of fossa, it is the posterior surface of this capsule of knee joint. And then finally, in the lower part, it is the popliteus muscle. Actually, popliteus will be even farther down, not here. This is the posterior surface of capsule of knee joint. And then you can see the common peroneal nerve going along the superolateral boundary, and it is giving the via this common trunk, it is giving the lateral cutaneous nerve of calf and the sural communicating nerve, which will eventually communicate with the sural nerve, which is branch of the tibial nerve, right? Have I missed anything? Then there is this fat, which is one of the other contents of popliteal fossa, and some lymph nodes are there. Then the genicular branches are not yet visible. I had found one branch of tibial nerve. This is most probably the middle genicular nerve. This is going down towards the posterior aspect of capsule of knee joint, and it would somewhere deep down, somewhere more distally, it would pierce the posterior aspect. We will be showing you more structures after cleaning it further. Thank you.